In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. We started like a month ago to give a brief talk about the Coptic rites and the Coptic church and the Coptic tradition. So I just remind you, with the last three lectures, we talked about lecture number one, we talked about the priest's liturgical garments. Then, lecture number two, we talked about altar clothing. And lecture number three, we talked about the offertory, which means the selection of the lamb, choosing the lamb or choosing the urbana, which is about to be offered like. So, today in the first lecture, this lecture and other lectures to come, we'll be talking about some of the hymns and some of the ritual praises that we use during our liturgical prayers, which is always prayed in the liturgy of the word. You know the liturgy of the word? We have the liturgy of the word, which is the first part of the liturgy, in which we listen to the Pauline Epistle, the Catholic Epistle, the Praxis, and the Synaxarium, the Gospel. This is called the Liturgy of the Word. And then we have the Liturgy of the Believers. So these lectures, these three lectures are talking about the Liturgy of the Word, today and on. Today, as you see in the screen, I will try to zoom. We have the Trisagion praise, which is Holy God, Holy Might, Holy Immortal. Or sometimes you hear it in Coptic tune, Agios, Otheos, Agios, Ishiros, Agios, Asanatos. You know, this is like three stanzas. The first three stanzas are talking or addressed to praise the Holy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we'll see that later. But I just try to focus on the words of this praise. Holy God, now we are talking in a clear voice to praise God. Holy God, Holy Immortal, we declare that God is immortal, is not subject to death, but He is the one who conquered death. Okay? Who was born of the Virgin? This is the first stanza, and we will talk right now about this addition. When was it added, and by whom was it? What was it added, and what is the reason for adding three words or four words? Who was born of the Virgin? So Agios and Coptic also. Agios means that he is not earthly. Is God, the Heavenly One. Agios, Otheos, you know, Otheos means God, Theos. Agios is Shiros. So the word Shiros, the Greek word, it means Iskeros, Shiros, or Abiskron, which means a strong with Almighty. Agios Athanatos. Agios, we know that's holy. And Athanatos, it means that he is not subject to death. He's not subject to death. Okay? He's not deadly at all. O Ekber Thenu, Ginnitis Elei Sunimes, O Ekber Thenu. O Ek Barthenos, which means through St. Mary, the Virgin. Genitis means the word coming from the origin, which Genesis, or the you know, Genesis means here that he was born from St. Mary. Okay? It's talking about the gynecology of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then the second stanza, that's Agios, Osos, Agios, Shros, Agios, Asanatos, O Stavrotis, the Imes, Eleison Imes. You know, Eleison Imes means have mercy on us. O Stavrotis, Astavrotis, he was crucified, Stavrotis, the Imes, on our behalf. Okay? The third stanza is talking about Agios, Osos, Agios, Shros, Agios, Asanatos. O Anastas Octon Necron, K. Anilson, Yestos, Uranos, Eleison Imes. O Anastas, and we said that Thanatos means death. O Anastas means he arose from the death, you know. Octon Necron means from the dead. Anilson estus uranos, anilsons like when we say in Coptic, means he was left to heaven. So the Lord Jesus Christ was born of the Holy Theotokos Saint Mary, and who was crucified on our behalf instead of us, and also he rose from the dead and he ascended to heaven. Okay? Then we say glory to the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto the age of ages. Amen. This is something brief about the words of the Trisagion. Also, the question now, when do we pray this Trisagion hymn? During the liturgy of the word. What's the exact time that we used to pray it? It's prayed in the Greek churches immediately following the reading of the Acts and Apostles and the Synaxarium. The Acts of Apostles and the Synaxarium. But in our tradition, it's very similar, but to be more accurate and more clear, we used to pray it right before the Holy Gospel. Sometimes in our tradition, we don't pray or don't say the Synaxarium. Like, you know, in the Holy 50 days, most of our Coptic churches do not read the Synaxarium. But no matter we will read the Synaxarium or not, we all the time in our liturgies, we pray the Trisagion hymn, which is Agios, Osos, Agios, Ishiros, Agios, Asanatos. Okay? So, regardless, we will read the Synaxarium or not, we all the time in our liturgical prayers, we pray the Trisagion hymn right before the reading of the Gospel. Okay? Which churches pray the Trisagion hymn? You know that we have a lot of traditions, we have a lot of churches, you know. Which churches do pray the Trisagion hymn? I can tell that almost all the churches praise this hymn. All the churches use this hymn to praise God, the Father, and the Son, the Holy Spirit, to praise the Holy Trinity. But we will see later that our Coptic church and our Coptic tradition modified it a little bit to be addressed in the beginning, in the first stanzas, to be addressed to the Holy Son. And this is for a reason, just to oppose some of the heresies which is spread around that time. The hymn, this hymn is one of the most widely hymns used in almost all churches. But our Coptic church has added, in the first stanza, added this phrase, who was born of the Virgin. In the second stanza, who was crucified for us. And in the third stanza, who rose from the dead and ascended to heaven. These three phrases have been added by the Coptic Church. You will see now the reason for this. It was added to reflect our church's own deep theology as well, we will discuss later, okay? The hymn, this hymn especially, is so special and especially important in the Byzantine Rite, and is prayed every liturgy. It's prayed every liturgy. But in the Western Roman churches and Catholic, it's typically just prayed in the Holy Friday, okay? So the Roman churches, they just use it in the Holy Friday. But in other Byzantinian churches, they use it all the time. The same like us, what we do. Now we have, you know, like a motto, or like common sayings, in the church, in the early church fathers, it was written in Latin. It says, lex orandi, lex credandi. Lex orandi, lex credandi, this is a Latin statement. We will explain it right now. It's almost said by Saint Jerome, okay? Which means what we believe in, we pray. And what we pray is what we believe in. What we believe in, we pray. Which means that our beliefs, our faith in God, our thoughts about God and theology is the material that we use to pray our praises and liturgies. And also, what we pray is what we believe in. Okay? Like the hymns you hear right now, Agios is us. It's not just a hymn or a song, but it is based on our belief in God to be the only God who was born of Saint Mary. And He is the one who was crucified. And He is the same one who was glorified and resurrected and ascended to heaven. So what we believe in, we pray. And what we pray is what we believe in. This is the concept that the early church fathers used. They said that they responded to the heresies, quoting the tradition of liturgical prayers that reflected the correct faith. So you know that in the first 4 or 5 centuries, there were a lot of heresies that spread. There were a lot of false teachings which rose against Christianity and rose against the Lord Jesus Christ, you know, to mislead people about the divinity of the Lord Jesus Christ, to mislead people about the Lord Jesus Christ being incarnate and taking flesh like us. So the liturgical prayers have been set to oppose these heresies and to address our teaching against them, okay? They also, the early fathers of the church, they also added to the liturgical tradition some prayers to reflect the correct understanding of a controversial topic. Like, for example, you know that we didn't have the creed, the Orthodox creed, which is we believe in one God, God the Father, the Pentecostal, the creator of heaven and earth. We didn't have it in the same text as you see right now, until the heresy of Arius spread and it began to corrupt the minds of people about, or to deviate them, make them deviate away from the right belief. So the church had like a communal assembly and they put to us the creed, the Orthodox creed. You hear about the assembly in Nicaea in 325, the year 325. So we didn't have these writings, we didn't have this liturgical texts until maybe the third or the mid of the third century, just to stand against the heresies at that time. So Trisagion hymn, the hymn is used in the liturgy to establish the correct theology in response to the Arian heresy. We will see right now that this hymn has been used by the church to stand against the Arians and also Nestorius, and to stand against the Chalcedonian thoughts at the time. You know, in order that Arius and his heresy was the first, then Nestorius came, then the Chalcedonian Council, okay? The Coptic Church, as I mentioned right now, mentioned to the first stanza, they added this phrase that he was born of the Theotokos of Saint Mary, and also he was crucified, and he rose from the dead. It's all to reflect the deep theology of the Church. Now, we have the biblical reference that I would love you to know that all our liturgical prayers and all our prayers in Agbaya, in the missal book, you know, which is Hulagi, and in Psalm the book, you know, all our prayers are taken from a biblical origins or a biblical sources. The biblical reference now to this hymn is mentioned in Isaiah and Isaiah's prophecy. Nebuchadnezzar Ashaiah chapter 6, verses 2 and 3, he says, above it stood the seraphim. Each one had 6 wings. With 2 he covered his face, with 2 he covered his feet, and with 2 he flew. And one cried to one another, said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. So we have a biblical reference to this hymn. Also, the Trisagion hymn is found in the most ancient discovered liturgies, and also and has been quoted by all or most of the early fathers of the church. And we'll right now mention, for example, two of these early fathers of the church. The Trisagion hymn is found in most of the different liturgies, for example, in St. James liturgy. St. James liturgy is one of the most famous liturgies in the early church. You know, St. James was the Bishop of Jerusalem, and he was one of the most brilliant pillars of the church. Okay? It was mentioned or wrote, it was found in the 4th century, used in the Antiochian church, which says in the St. James liturgy, it says, Holy God, Holy Might, Holy Mortal, have mercy on us. Glory be to the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This is what is said in St. James liturgy. And St. James liturgy is as old as St. Mark's liturgy. You know that some of the fathers say that it's even older than St. Mark. Let me see with you right now two quotes or two sayings by the Holy Fathers of the Church affirming the authenticity of this praise. St. Cyril of Jerusalem, St. Cyril of Jerusalem within the 4th century, and he is also one of the most famous fathers in our church, and we, until now, we are leaning and we are depending on the great sayings and the great treasures that he left us in our tradition. He said about the Trisagion hymn, he said that as we praise God with this heavenly hymn that was passed to us by the seraphim, we participate in thanksgiving, in a thanksgiving praise together with the angelic figures. Which means that praying this hymn gives us the chance to share the seraphim and to share with the angels to praise God. This is a praise that has been prayed by the angels. St. John Chrysostom, he says, he also was in the end of the 4th century and the beginning of the 5th century. He said about the Trisagion hymn, a holy God who is resting among the holy ones, praised by the seraphim with the thrice holy voice, glorified by the cherubim, and worshipped by every celestial power, you have brought all things into being out of nothing. As if he is using this praise also to magnify the Lord Jesus Christ, magnify God, who brought everything from into existence out of non-existence. Okay? The Trisagion hymn in the Coptic Church. We had an idea right now about the Trisagion hymn. But let us focus to get deeper with our Coptic tradition. Why did our Coptic church start to use this hymn and is it still holding fast, steadfast, to pray it every liturgy? I mentioned a few seconds ago that it has a biblical reference. And also we have another reference which is very authentic. It came to us from the Coptic tradition. It says that the righteous Joseph and Nicodemus took away the body of the Lord Jesus Christ to wrap him, and they already wrapped him in linen clothes to put it in the grave. You know, but they had like some doubts and the thoughts about, did the Lord Jesus Christ really rose from the dead? Will he rise from the dead? They're not sure about it. So they doubted, and the doubts entered to their minds concerning the divinity of the Lord Jesus Christ. And all of a sudden, a choir of angels, not just one angel, a choir of angels appeared to them, singing this hymn, saying, Holy God, Holy Mighty, Holy Immortal. Just to let them know that the Lord Jesus Christ, whom you see him like a dead body right now, is just in flesh. But he is immortal. He is not subject to death. So the two righteous people don't realize their error, and they joined singing with the hymns, this hymn with the angel saying, Holy God, Holy Almighty, holy, immortal. And they added also some few words with them, that the Lord Jesus Christ, he was crucified and he will be resurrected from the dead to raise us up with him. Okay. The Coptic Church also always had this idea and understood that the Trisagion hymn is addressed to God the Son. Because we say, who was born of the Virgin? And we all know that the only divine person who was born of the Virgin is the Lord Jesus Christ. We all know and agree that the Holy Father was not born from the Saint Mary, and the Holy Spirit was not born from Saint Mary. The only divine person who was born of Saint Mary is the Holy Son. And the only divine person who was crucified also is the Lord Jesus Christ. And the only one who rose from the dead was the Lord Jesus Christ also. We all agree with that. You know, we are confident that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are equal in essence, are equal in theology, are equal in divinity, are equal in everything. But we also believe that they are distinct. The Father is not the Son, is not the Holy Spirit. We believe in that we have believe in the Holy Father to be God, the Holy Son to be God. The Holy Spirit is also God, but the Holy Father is not the Holy Spirit. So the only one who was born of the Virgin is the Lord Jesus Christ. The one who was crucified is only the Holy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. The one who rose from the dead is only the Lord Jesus Christ. So other churches, like the Byzantine churches, they use this hymn, but they believe that it's addressed to the Holy Trinity, the Father and the Son, the Holy Spirit together. By the way, the first three stanzas are really addressed to the Holy Son. And then the tune is changed. We say, O Holy Trinity, have mercy on us. O Holy Trinity, have mercy on us. O Holy Trinity, have mercy on us. Why? The reason is that we focus that the only one who was born from Saint Mary is Lord Jesus Christ, and he was crucified and he rose from the dead. But also we believe that God the Father is as equal as the Holy Son and the Holy Spirit, so we believe the Holy Trinity. But being really confident and believing in the Holy Trinity, we also can distinguish that they are distinct persons. We also know that the Father is not the Son, is not the Holy Spirit, okay? But we believe in the Holy Trinity to be the Lord God. Trisagion hymn in the Coptic tradition. In older Coptic tradition, this hymn was played by the priests and the congregation respond to him. Then the priest in this case represented the seraphim, okay? As mentioned in the book of Isaiah. But later on, especially in, I think, in the 7th century, it began to be a tradition that deacons on both sides of the choir began to alternate singing together. They start from the north and the other one in the right hand respond to them. The deacons also use a fan made from ostrich or peacock feathers, like which is called flabellum, and the altar around the Holy Eucharist. This implies the seraphim to represent around or present around God's throne, while the hymn "Holy, Holy, Holy" is prayed. Something that might be still in most of the churches, but يعني مش عايز أقول إن إحنا we've been lazy شوية in using these fans. المراوح بتشوف الشمامسة كده use the fans أو المراوح كده to represent the seraphim standing around the throne of God. You know that the temple refers to the heavens and the sanctuary, and also the altar refers to the throne of God. عرش الله. Also, one of the most significant points I will mention right now about this hymn, and then I will be done. Yeah. The Trisagion hymn stood against the heretics. First, one of them was Arianism. You know what Arius used to say that the Lord Jesus Christ is not as superior as the Lord the Father. He is, you know, he is not the same. He is not good as good as the Father. He is not as divine as the Father. This was Arius's heresy. So the early church fathers used this hymn against Arianism and Arius. This hymn is saying that the divinity of God the Son is the same and equivalent to God the Father. Both hypostases are holy, mighty, and immortal. So historically, the addition to the Trisagion, this phrase which says he was born, he was crucified, and he rose from the dead, was first made in Antioch and in the period of the patriarchate of the patriarch whose name was Eustathius. It was in the 4th century. Eustathius was one of the brilliant opponents of Arianism. In the addition to the Trisagion, he added these phrases, which must have been in the Antiochian before this time. It was also intended to reinforce our Orthodox teaching about the divinity of the Lord Jesus Christ, that he is God incarnate and became man and was crucified to save us from the sentence of death. This is for the Arianism. And also, Trisagion stood against the heresies of the Theopaschites. Theopaschites are those who believed, the people who believed, that the Holy Trinity suffered together. You know, we believe that the Lord Jesus Christ only is the one who suffered and who was crucified and who hung on the cross. But the Theopaschites are heretics. يعني هرطقة كانوا بيقولوا إن الثالوث كله تألم مع بعض. The thing that we don't believe in. طبعا إحنا مش بنؤمن بكده. So the Coptic Church continued using this word, who was crucified for us. So who was born of the Virgin? Automatically, we understand that this is the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son. And he was crucified, it means that the Son who was born of the Virgin is the Son also who was crucified to save us. In response to Arianism, as we mentioned right now. The Coptic Church also used words who was born of the Virgin to clearly indicate that the hymn is addressed to God the Logos and not the Holy Trinity. Because I mentioned now that not the whole Holy Trinity was born of the Virgin, but just the Lord Jesus Christ. Clearly, it's indicating that the hymn is for the Son, and which opposes the heresy of the Theopaschites. This heresy, it says that the Holy Trinity suffered together. This was done also to oppose the Nestorius. You know Nestor? Nestor, okay? Nestorius heresy, and it proclaimed that the Theotokos bore the Holy God, the Logos, with his humanity and divinity. Because Nestor did not believe that the Lord Jesus Christ was fully God and fully man at the same time, since being conceived in the womb of Saint Mary. Because, you know, Nestor claimed that he was just man, and then like it's a kind of unity between or friendship between the theology, divinity, sorry, and humanity. They began in unity later on. This is not true. This is not true. Saint Cyril the Great says that the unity between humanity and divinity came at the same and the very moment of conception. يعني لحظة الحبل الإلهي من العذراء. He's full God and full man. It's okay? This was done also to oppose the Nestorius, as I mentioned right now. Trisagion also stood against heretics of diophysitism, which means that two natures and two wills of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is one of the consequences of the heresy of Nestor. Later, the Coptic Church added also that he who rose from the dead. He rose from the dead. Why? Because it clearly indicates that the Logos was crucified with his own will, is the same one who rose from the dead with his own power also. He was not forced, by the way, to die. He was not forced. He, with his own will, he willingly, happily, offered himself as a sacrifice on the cross. And with all his power and might, he rose from the dead to raise us up with him. This was also done to oppose the heresy of the diophysitism to natures like which was mentioned in the Canon of Chalcedonian. You know, the church is saying, our church is saying that Christ is God in human form. He does not have two wills nor two natures the same. The Lord Jesus Christ, the same suffering God on the cross, is the same glorious God with resurrection. They, like St. Paul says in Roman 1:25, he says that he rose, he was crucified for our sins and justify and rose, sorry, and rose from the dead to justify us. يعني أسلم لأجل خطايانا وأقيم لأجل تبريرنا. أسلم لأجل خطايانا وأقيم لأجل تبريرنا. He is the same God. This is the reason also why St. Paul said in Romans 8, verse 17, if we suffered with him, we will be also glorified with him. Because he is the Lord Jesus Christ, who was crucified to save us, and he is the Lord Jesus Christ, who also rose from the dead to save us and to raise us with him. Glory be to our God forever and ever. Amen.